The question is, what is the purpose of this part of the statement? The purpose of this part of the statement in parentheses is that to demonstrate, to be more explicit, when we begin working with this console application, objects such as system out and system in are created for us before the main method is invoked. Therefore, we start working in Java, especially when we're dealing with console application, that some objects already exist in memory. And examples of these are these two, system in and system out, designed to represent standard input and output devices. So supposedly this is a system in object, system in right here, and this is a system out at the bottom, system out. They have those long names, I abbreviate them to S in and S out. And then it appears that we're using, let me resize this so that I can display everything. In this statement here, we say scanner, create new scanner, and we pass system in as a reference to this already existing object. So what happens is that a reference, and I will use like a, you know, little punctured line, which is, you know, a reference that exists to this object, right? But what happens is that we take it and we store it inside our scanner. So the scanner actually remembers where this object is. And that's the reason why system in is required to construct the scanner. And so that the scanner actually remembers where the system input is. Yes. No, the scanner is a brand new object, and system in and system out are separate objects.
But scanner is a reserved word, right?
Scanner is not a reserved word.
Okay, so
you can create your own class.
Using the word scanner.
We're just using the word scanner, and to find out that this is really not a reserved word is that we have to import it. We have to say, somewhere in Java package, under util package, there is a scanner defined by Java API. And we make it available to us by using the import statement. The painful part here is to remember where to go in the library to bring it in, to make compiler happy when we say new scanner. So in reality, what happens is that it retrieves the definition of the scanner from Java API library. There is a class named scanner defined inside the library.
So it does a different job than system in.
Absolutely, yes, it does a different job. And this is a true picture. We deal with system in, which is managed for us by the scanner. But the scanner is completely separate instance, completely separate object, and two different types, and they just cooperate. So when we, for example, say scanner execute next in method, what happens here is that the scanner delegates, you know, retrieves information from system in object, gets the information, processes it, and packages an integer for us and returns back right here a brand new value for our integer. So there is the both objects continue to interoperate and continue to be in use as we use the scanner. Conveniently for us, once we pass system into the scanner, we can forget about it and pretend that the scanner itself represents everything that we need to do with our input from the keyboard. The situation will change somewhat when we begin to work with files, which are basically also input devices in the system. there, unfortunately, you can no longer forget about every single part that your file processing is made with. And in that case, you will have to go sometimes different parts of the file processing API will have to be used with files. But with simple inputs such as keyboard, the scanner, once created, is good enough to do a lot of work with the keyboard. So I guess we have to get used to this and grasp the look and feel for now. Okay, what I'm trying to address right now is to essentially walk us through this statement. So the statement says that the new operator is used when we have to create objects of our own. To truly create objects of our own, we have to perhaps use a separate file with the class defined in it, and you can create your own brand new class. But right now, we're saying a lot of classes already created for us in the library. And if we use the import statement, we can refer compiler to particular location in the library and can create classes defined there, instantiate objects which somehow may be useful to us. The scanner, of course, is extremely useful object. Here's another example. There is a special data type which is good for keeping track of dates, just calendar dates, and manipulate dates. So here's the date class, which is, by the way, also coming from the util package. So we'll work with these later on. But there's another example where you can capture the current date and time. The variable is named now by saying new date. And new date object, by default, here doesn't take any initial parameters, creates an object which will contain captures and will contain the current date and time. It's not going to continuously update current date and time, but it's a snapshot of a date and time at the time of creation. So once we have objects, such as SC scanner in my case, I can call methods which are provided by these objects. So before we define our own classes of objects, we just introduce that there is a good possibility that you may go out and use existing classes in the library, which can be very useful. A couple of examples here. If I am expecting some double value, like 3.14 in the input, then I can say next double. In my sample here, using scanner, I said next int, expecting the user to type an integer in response. So similarly, if I capture date and name that now, which is an object that captures the date information, there is another method named toString, converts date to string, and so I can actually make it printable. Because internal storage of date is just like a combination of fields which contain zeros and ones, which represent different parts to it. Seconds, hours, date, month, year, all that in a certain combination. So it's not necessarily human-friendly or human-readable, unless you know what each part represents. And even then, you need to do some computations to be able to convert between different fields. But conveniently, the library provides the same method on the date class, which says toString. And so you can quickly convert it to string, save it as string, and then maybe print it and so forth. So import statements are needed to import parts of the library. There are different parts of the library. I have a slide on different packages that represent different parts of the library. Much more on this in the second part of our class, when we really begin to use library facilities continuously. So in the second semester, in the spring semester, we'll be working with lots of many different parts of the library, working with files, graphical parts of the library, as well as dates and times and other calculations. So, but the import statement typically can be expressed in two different formats. So the package name is actually not necessarily one word, but it may be consisting of multiple words. And therefore, somewhere there are multiple subdirectories. For example, to format numbers in different manner, there is a number format object which can be created. And the class number format is defined in Java text package. So this is the name of the package, Java text. And this is the name of the class. So it's this form, package name, class name. In our example here, it's Java util is the package name, and the scanner is the name of the class. And the class, of course, represents the type of object that, we'll be creating. Or you can say, well, you know, I really don't want to bother with remembering what classes I really need from that package. And you can use a wildcard, the asterisk. This is a wildcard. And just say, well, give me everything from this package, and I'll be happy to use them as needed. So, but still, you need to recall and remember where those things exist. So, given the fact that it can be somewhat painful, because sometimes you can make a mistake and make some changes and add and remove code and this and that, make modifications to your import statements, right? So sometimes you will get confused, compiler will get confused, and it's really, really useful in NetBeans, this function. You can, like, you know, go to, I think it's in the tools, and there is tools or source, rather, source fix imports. So fixing imports is basically asking NetBeans, well, you know what the common locations of these library classes are, so give me some help. So fixed imports actually will prompt you for, you know, particular locations for package-wise where your classes may be located. And to quickly demonstrate it, one second, just a question. So if I did say date equals date now, now equals date, right, and wanted to capture it. So again, we don't know where this symbol is located, but we can say, well, I can go to source and say fix imports, right? Fix imports, and it kind of tells me, so you really want to fix it, so look at how many different definitions I have for you, but Java util date is really the one that perhaps we want. And what happens here is that it just adds another import statement on top. So if I did this, then I say, well, I'm using so many different classes from this package that I really don't need individual imports for individual classes, and I could use this wildcard. Question.
Problem.